Okay, now Representative Pimentel, I may not agree with Lorraine Badoy's manner, her behavior, her tactics in the past with how she's treated and ragtag journalists, but I want to stick to this issue. Isn't this an abuse of power and discretion by the lower house? I mean, what did the two really violate? Number one, when you think about it, the Soto law is quite clear. Whether or not you agree with our commentary, it does protect them from revealing their sources. The law is quite clear on that. So what is the basis to detain them for this long?
Well, there is a SOTO law, no, to protect media practitioners. However, there is also colletilla in the SOTO law. It's very clear there in section one, only accredited journalists can invoke the SOTO law. In this case, we have found out that Lauren Badoy and Mr. Celis are not accredited journalists or media practitioners with KBP. In fact, KBP was there. They testified that they are not accredited. So it's very clear in Section 1 of Republic Act Number 147, expanding the coverage of exemptions, nakalagay doon, accredited journalist, writer, reporter, contributor. And there is also an exemption unless the court or the House of Representatives or the Senate or any Congress finds that such revelation is demanded by the security of the state. So we were talking about red tagging. We were talking about communist insurgency. It's very clear that it involves the security of the state. And in the course of two hearings that we have conducted, last November 30 and yesterday, we have established already that they have violated some provisions in their franchise. Actually, it is Swarasug Media Corporation who has been given the franchise. It's not SMNI. SMNI is just a trademark of Swarasug Media Corporation under Republic Act Number 11422. They were an act renewing the franchise of Swarasug. But upon during our in the course of our hearing, we have established they have violated some sections of Republic Act 11422, especially on Section 4, Section 10, Section 11, and Section 12. Now, Section 4 specifically states that the grantee, the franchise holder, shall not use its station as facilities for the broadcasting of obscene, indecent language, speech, act, or scene, and more importantly, for the dissemination of deliberately false information or willful misrepresentation to the detriment of the public interest. Now, during the hearing on November 30, Eric Celis admitted that his source was false. Yung information na binigay sa kanya ng source niya was false because we presented to him, he accused Congress and the Speaker that we spent 1.8 billion pesos in traveling expenses. But upon verification from the Secretary General and the Finance Department head, that actually Speaker Romualdez spent only 4.3 million pesos and the Congress spent only 35 million pesos. So this is clearly a false information which falls under Section 4. And not only that, we have also seen that SMNI is facing so many cases in different bodies. They have cases in KBP, they have cases in MTRCB, they have cases in NTC, even in Ombudsman, even in Professional Regulation Commission, all pertaining maligning, attacking individuals by using false information. So this is already a testament and evidence that SMNI is being used as a tool to attack, to malign, destroy the reputation of individuals and entities by using false information.
Okay, all right. This is good that you're actually being so detailed about this, Representative. So first, let me just slice up some of the things you've said. In terms of the wrong information, I am against this information. So it is the responsibility of the host or the journalist to prove, right, that that the speaker had spent 1.8 billion. If that particular journalist or person doesn't have evidence to back it up, and records have come out that the speaker had spent another amount, there is another recourse for the speaker or other individuals, which is to file for libel. Or are you asking for SM&I to issue a retraction or issue an apology?
During the November 30 hearing, I asked Mr. Celis if he will admit that he had a wrong information. Then he did admit, and then I asked him if he was willing to recant his testimony and apologize to Congress. He is willing, but then he did not do it. This is another matter. Saying that he's willing to apologize, he's willing to recant his testimony, but after the hearing, he again attacked the Congress, he attacked several congressmen. So where is good faith there, and where is his sincerity? So again, as I've said, and in many instances, SM&I is being used. In fact, there is a case, I think, facing in MPRC or NTC regarding his allegations that former Vice President Robredo had links with the Communist Party. Again, he cannot back it up. So again, this is another false information which falls under Section 4. Not only that, Karen, hindi lang Section 4 ang violate nila. They are also in violation of Section 10, 11, 12, in Section 11.
All right. Yeah. Okay, so clearly what you're trying to prove is they violated the requirements and the legalities of their franchise, right?
Yes, correct.
Okay, but the problem in this country is, for example, with Congress too, and forgive me by bringing this up, is SM&I was flourishing, even more than tolerated flourishing during the time of former President Duterte, to the point that SM&I was considered like the mainstream media of where even the president or cabinet secretaries would speak. And you had Congress shutting down ABS-CBN, which was a legitimate television network. So, Representative, here we are today. Kumbaga, nagpalit ang Pangulo, bago na ang Speaker, iba na ang nasa kapangyarihan. What's very difficult is the fact that it's not about institutions or a respect for the freedom of the press. It's about sino ang nasa poder. So ngayon, ang SM&I na ang tagal na nating alam, lumalabag sa batas. In the 6 years, they flourished. They were untouchable. And now that Duterte is no longer in power, now all this is coming to light. I mean, frankly speaking, the Robredo case, that's been there for so long. So, ang tanong dito, Representative, ito, if their franchise will not be renewed or it will be cut, on what basis is it now? Some people may think, oh, it's about politicking. Kasi it's about the next elections. You understand me, sir? Right?
Aaron, this is not about politics, and you cannot compare also ABS-CBN to Suara Sub or SM&I, because yung sa ABS-CBN, the franchise expired. This time around, we are looking at the possible revocation of the franchise of Suara Sub. It's not about politics, it's about the public interest. We have seen SM&I in the past few years or so many years being used to attack individuals, entities. And I believe Congress just took it upon themselves that enough, this is enough. Tama na po itong paninira and using false information. It's about violation of Republic Act 11422, and it is within the legal bounds of Congress to act on this. Remember that a franchise is not a right given an individual or a entity. It's just a privilege given by the state through Congress.
Yes.
Therefore, since Congress has the power to grant, it has also the power to amend repeal or revoke in the interest of the public. And in this case, we can see that the interest or the public interest is already involved. So many cases have been filed against them. So but many individuals have been oppressed, harassed by SMNI. So I believe that we should take action on it.
Yes, I agree with your point there. And just to move back a little bit on the situation is, yes, you are right. The franchise of ABS did expire, but then there was still a non-renewal. And I wanted to add, one of the frequencies of ABS-CBN actually went to SMNI, right?
Yes, I believe so.
Yeah. So right now, the bigger issue is the landscape of media also in general. You have a media network, SMNI, which may not be practicing ideal journalism, the contextualizing issues for the public, or there may be a certain amount of abuse. But the question also is, if you revoke the franchise, and I'm not saying you shouldn't revoke it, is what happens then to the media landscape in the Philippines? Because you also, you're talking about as a whole, networks in general, you're getting into a smaller landscape of media networks.
Karen, we're not trying to curtail the freedom of expression. It's a constitutional right of every Filipino citizen. As I've said, we are there also to see if the franchise holder is really following the provision sections of the franchises. And as I've said, we have already established in the two hearings that SMNI has violated so many sections or provisions of their franchise. And I think Congress is doing the right thing. And I don't believe you mentioned earlier that SMNI is the mainstream. I don't think so. The TV network is being used for entertainment, for disseminating important information to the public.
No, but during the time of former President Duterte, they were the go-to channel. I mean, you had cabinet secretaries. They were the source of information, even that president would be there to be interviewed. Do you understand? I'm trying to...
Well, probably because there was a perception that the Pastor Apollo Cobiloy was very close to former President Duterte, and former President Duterte used the platform of SMNI. So there was a perception that this was the favored TV network of the president. Yeah. So therefore, alam mo naman ang Philippine politics, whoever is in power, everyone will go to that power. So in that sense, during that time of President Duterte, since he was always seen in SMNI, probably the politicians or the public officials thought that it would be better to be seen in SMNI to have favors from the president.
I agree. But, look where we are now.
If you will say that SMNI is a mainstream TV network, I would disagree with that.
No. I am not saying they are, but I'm trying to say as a whole here that what gave SMNI the importance was no less than the former president himself. That's what I'm saying.
But yes, that's true.
That's what I'm trying to say, to the point that mainstream media, to a degree, was seconded during that particular time, because all information, a lot, not all, there was a lot of information that was coming out of SMNI. You're right, because of his perceived closeness to the president. But let's move forward. YouTube has acted. YouTube has already shut down Cibuloy's channel. We know the cases against Apollo Cibuloy in the United States, trafficking cases, human trafficking cases, also their rights abuses against him. So YouTube has acted. So clearly it is within the power of Congress to revoke the franchise. What is the possibility of this, Representative Pimentel?
There is a big possibility in a revoking. In fact, yesterday, for the information of everyone, we already passed a resolution urging National Telecommunications Commission to suspend the airing and the of SMNI. So it is now up to the National Telecommunication Commission whether they were up on it. And then we will have another hearing. I believe there's a bill actually that is being passed to revoke the franchise of SMNI. And based on the two hearings that I attended, we have evidence proving that they have violated several sections of their franchise, and it is a ground we have every reason to revoke their franchise.
Okay. And what are you seeing? Is it, will the plenary vote on this? How will it work? If the Committee on Legislative Franchises finds the violations, the committee recommends the revocation. Do you take a vote in the plenary to revoke?
Yes, it will be brought up to a vote. And again, it will have to be concurred by the Senate. That is the process of our legislative body, no? So there will be a bill filed, then it will be voted upon by Congress. Then upon approval of Congress, it will have to be concurred by the Senate.
Okay. I'm curious, the charges against Apollo Kibuloy in the United States, he is charged, he is wanted in the United States, but it's foreign jurisdiction. Is that a factor in a violation of a franchise?
No. That is another matter. We are not delving into the cases of Apollo Kibuloy in the States, and it's not in any way related to the violations that I have mentioned to you.
Okay. All right. Now, on a bigger scale, Representative Pimentel, I think it's also, I wanted to ask you, it's about where we are right now as a country in terms of mainstream media, in terms of the press, in terms of disinformation. These are people that thrived essentially in the past administration. I mean, you have Lorraine Badoy that actually, well, you have Atom Araulio, a journalist that already filed charges against her for red tagging, the former vice president, Lenny Robredo. So we're in a situation, how do we move out of this situation ideally, where it's not about who is in power, but it's a real genuine respect for institutions?
That is why we are doing this right now, Karen, so that we could police or monitor, supervise that the TV network should abide also by their responsibilities to the public.
But you do have some people asking if it wasn't the speaker who was skipped. Because in this situation, Congress came out in full force because he hit the speaker. The allegations were against the speaker. So you have regular people asking if it wasn't the speaker. I mean, when they did this to Lenny Robredo, Congress didn't come out full force. When they red-tagged journalists, Congress didn't come out full force. So because the allegation is against the speaker, you're all out there full force.
Because there was already a pattern that we have seen. If you recall, this was not the first incident that they attacked the institution. Congress is an institution. And before this incident, there were several aired programs attacking the speaker, attacking Congress, and other individual congressmen are being attacked and by impact threatened. So Congress took it upon themselves to protect the institution, especially the integrity of the institution.
All right. Okay. Well, I think on another note, I wanted to ask you, well, this isn't part already of your committee, but there is a resolution. You have two House committees that actually adopted the resolutions urging the government to cooperate with the International Criminal Court in terms of investigating the drug war. Where do you stand on that, sir?
I think it would be better for the country to join again the ICC because in 2019, we withdrew from the ICC, because accordingly, the Filipino citizen should be tried in the Philippine courts, not by any foreign court. But I think this time it would be better for us to join the ICC.
Okay, all right. So does that mean this is the speaker's opinion as well?
No, I'm not speaking for myself and for probably other congressmen. There were two congressmen who filed that resolution. It was Congressman Abante and Congressman Gutierrez, but it's still being deliberated in the committee.
All right. Okay, on that note, I want to thank you so much for joining me today. It's always such a pleasure to speak with you, sir. Representative Johnny Pimentel, thank you.
Thank you, Karen.